Hallo, herzlich willkommen bei diesem ersten Mal, dass wir das IHS-Seminar live virtuell zeigen über Microsoft Teams. Herzlich willkommen an alle da draußen. Erfahrungsgemäß werden jetzt in den nächsten paar Minuten noch ein paar Leute zusätzlich eintreffen. Das heißt, ich werde die Zeit jetzt noch verwenden, ein paar Ankündigungen zu machen, bevor wie ich dann das Wort gebe an Katharina Gangl, die uns heute etwas erzählen wird über ein Paper, das sie geschrieben hat, gemeinsam mit Benno Torgler, How to Achieve Tax Compliance by the Wealthy. Mein Name ist Thomas König. Gemeinsam mit Susanne Forstner veranstalte oder koordiniere ich diese Seminarreihe, in der Wissenschaftler und Wissenschaftlerinnen des IHS einmal monatlich, in Zukunft vielleicht auch öfter, ihre Forschungsergebnisse präsentieren. Wir richten dieses Seminar vor allem an Mitarbeiterinnen des IHS, aber wir haben es auch absichtlich online gestellt, dass es auch Leute von extern sich zuschalten können und zuschauen können. Ich möchte zu Beginn darauf hinweisen, dass dieses Event auch aufgezeichnet wird und auf unserer Homepage nachträglich veröffentlicht wird in einem YouTube-Kanal. Der Vortrag wird auch unter dem Einladungslink als Aufzeichnung zur Verfügung stehen. Es gibt auch eine IHS-Datenschutzerklärung und den Link dazu finden Sie in der Fragen- und Antwort-Section von dieser Aufzeichnung oder von diesem Livecast. Für alle, die eine Frage stellen wollen, gibt es die Möglichkeit, in der Menüzeile unterhalb von dem Bild Q&A, das ist so eine zwei Sprechblasen mit einer Fragezeichen drinnen, das zu öffnen und dann dort eine Frage zu schreiben. Ich werde während dem Vortrag von Katharina diese Q&A-Leiste immer verfolgen und werde jene Q&As, die inhaltlich gut passen, dann so moderiert dann an die Katharina im Anschluss weitergeben, beziehungsweise wenn es wirklich eine Ad-hoc-Frage ist, unter Umständen auch intervenieren, aber das werde ich versuchen eher nicht zu tun, wenn es nicht wirklich ganz dringend ist. Es kann gut sein, dass ich ähnliche Fragen versuche zusammenzufassen. Ich werde aber immer dazu sagen, von wem die Frage kommt, damit ich da gegebenenfalls auch klar mache, dass da möglicherweise noch Schärfungsfragen dazu kommen können. Falls es Fragen gibt, die nur an den oder die Vortragenden nur an die Katharina gerichtet sein sollen und die nicht online vorgelesen werden sollen, dann bitte extra dazu schreiben, weil dann kann ich das im Nachhinein mit der Katharina noch austauschen und sie wird dann gerne mit dir oder mit Ihnen in Kontakt treten. Wenn du oder wenn ihr eingeloggt seid und die Frage trotzdem anonym gestellt werden soll, dann bitte einfach beim Fragestellen auf anonym posten gehen. Das gibt es auch als Feature. Ja, ich möchte noch dazu sagen, dass das das erste Mal ist, dass wir dieses Seminar live haben. Und ich freue mich ganz besonders, dass die Katharina bereit ist, hier auch ein bisschen das mit uns zu testen. Wir sitzen hier das erste Mal auch im IHS-Produktionsraum. Das ist auch für uns neu, das hier zu gestalten. Das heißt, auch da wird es noch ein bisschen ans Lernen gehen und zu schauen, wie das funktioniert. Nichtsdestotrotz bin ich mir sicher, dass das jetzt ein wahnsinnig toller und spannender Vortrag wird. Und ich würde jetzt gleich an die Katharina geben. Davor möchte ich sie aber noch ganz kurz vorstellen. Katharina Gangl ist Wirtschaftspsychologin, hat, glaube ich, vor einem halben Jahr am IHS angefangen, war davor an der Universität Wien und auch in Deutschland. Und sie ist im Augenblick im IHS-Kompetenzzentrum Inside Austria. Das ist das Behavioral, also verhaltensökonomische Kompetenzzentrum des IHS unter Martin Kocher. Sie macht eine Reihe von ganz spannenden Forschungsprojekten und ich glaube, das, was sie heute vorstellt, ist ein Thema, das besonders viele interessiert und vor allem, es ist, glaube ich, entstanden, ganz sicher entstanden vor der Covid-19-Krise, aber es ist ein Thema, das mit Sicherheit mit der Covid-19-Krise nochmal sehr, sehr verschärft auf uns zukommen wird in der Zukunft. How to Achieve Tax Compliance by the Wealthy, a Review of the Literature and Agenda for Research and Policy. Und damit gebe ich gerne schon das Wort an Katharina. Bitteschön.
Thank you, Thomas, for your introduction and welcome from the production room of the IHS. As Thomas said, I'm an economic psychologist, and most of my previous years in research I spent on tax compliance. So about 10 years or so, I just studied the tax compliance or psychological basis of tax compliance of average citizens. And for 3 years now, I focused on the tax compliance of the wealthy. And today I present you the nucleus of this research, which is literature research, basically, although I already started with empirical studies. The talk of today will mainly address the empirical work that was presented in the literature already. The paper was conducted or written together with my friend Benno Torgler and was published this year in January in the journal Social Issues and Policy Review. Of course, I cannot present everything, so only the maybe most relevant parts. I think I will take about 30 to 40 minutes, and in detail, I will spend my time. Just check how to go to the next slide. In detail, I will spend the next 30 to 40 minutes on the following topics. First, I would like to talk a little bit more about the relevance of the topic. Then I will present some research which makes the claim that the wealthy are less tax compliant than average taxpayers. And the largest part of my presentation will focus on the question why the wealthy are less tax compliant than average taxpayers. And we said, or we concluded, that the differences are related to the political economic context, so the macro level, and also differences on the social and individual level. Finally, I make some policy interventions, or I will make some conclusions how we could use this literature for some policy interventions. And I also will relate this research to current corona crisis. So what can we learn from this research to solve this current crisis? And then I conclude, and I'm happy if you have any questions or comments for me. Okay, let's start. I always hear the same comment as Thomas just said before, that research on taxes is a very hot topic. So actually, almost every week it's in the newspaper, not just tax compliance by the wealthy, but in general, tax compliance is a hot topic almost all of the time. Most research or most media reports deal with the question of why do so many people evade taxes? So it's a big problem that all over the world, large fractions of the budget are lost due to aggressive tax avoidance, but also tax evasion. On the right-hand side, you see a list, and these are only estimations, of course, but this is a list of European countries and which country loses the largest fraction to tax evasion, not just by wealthy individuals, but also due to tax evasion conducted by large companies, but this is often related. And of course, we have to make clear that this tax evasion or also aggressive tax avoidance is also related to criminal activities, to drug trafficking, human trafficking, and things like that. Although Italy is not the biggest economy in Europe, it suffers the most from tax evasion and avoidance. And some of you might know that Italy has all these problems with the public budget. And we can assume if Italy would have the same compliance rates, so if people or if the citizens of Italy would have the same attitudes towards tax honesty, then, for example, citizens in Austria or Germany, then their problems would be much smaller concerning public deficits. Also in Greece, the last financial crisis was the same problem, that they have particularly high rates of tax evasion. This was most of the time just a media talk about tax evasion and the problems. Also, of course, in politics it was a problem, but it was not so much of interest in the academic world. That changed in the recent years. However, most research was done by economists on macro data, There are lots of discussions also how to actually estimate tax evasion. In the end, these are activities who are taking place in the shadows of the normal economy, so we always talk about estimations. But nonetheless, we can be sure that there is a huge fraction of money lost due to tax evasion and aggressive tax avoidance schemes. One famous quote was from Rutger Bregman in the last World Economic Forum, where he said, tax evadence and evasion and avoidance are the biggest problems of our times. So on the one hand side, we have the problem of maybe too little tax compliance by the wealthy. But on the other hand, we have to acknowledge that a very small fraction in the population contributes substantially to our public budgets. Before the Trump administration, just 2.7% of the US population paid more than 50% of the total income tax. So although we have wealthy individuals who try everything they can to evade and avoid taxes, we also have a large fraction of citizens, of wealthy citizens, who pay their taxes honestly. And the question is, why do we have this difference? Why do some people decide to evade and avoid as much as they can, whereas others decide to make a contribution to the public good in order to pay for hospitals, for infrastructure, and so on? Somehow, this is also a psychological question. However, it is practically not addressed in the literature. There's actually almost no psychological research that deals with the psychological reasons of a wealthy person to be honest or dishonest. And because of this huge gap in the literature, which I noticed some years ago, because I was a reviewer for the European Union, I decided to start this research. And today I first want to present you some data which shows some insights on the tax compliance of the wealthy. Most of these studies were never done with a focus on the wealthy. Most of these studies just also assessed income. And because of that, we can also make some conclusions how income varies with tax compliance. So what do we know on the tax compliance differences between wealthy and average taxpayers? Because actually, if the wealthy would have the same behavioral patterns than average taxpayers, we wouldn't need special research on the wealthy. But this is not the case. We have some field evidence. So this is data based on from the revenue authorities over several decades. Some researchers, mostly economists, analyzed revenue data, so the relationship in particular between income and tax honesty, tax evasion. And they found that there is a negative relationship. So the wealthier a person gets, the more income this person evades. More recent data from tax havens, Switzerland and Panama, make the same conclusions, even in more drastic terms. They analyzed and compared the tax behavior of households in Norway, Sweden and Denmark, with more than 40 million in net wealth with the household, with average households, and found that these very wealthy households evade about 30% of their income, whereas an average taxpayer evades just 3% of income. So on a behavioral level, we can make the conclusion that there is a difference in tax honesty between wealthy and average taxpayers. And this is not something that you can easily come up with, because normally you would assume a poorer a person is, the more, the higher the necessity to evade taxes, because this person actually needs the money. So we actually could also assume very easily that poor people or average income people should evade much more, for example, by being involved in the shadow economy and so on, than wealthy people, because they really need the money more. But that's not the case. Behavioral data shows that wealthy people decide to avoid more taxes than average people. And this is not just something that we find on the behavioral level, but also on the attitude side. So even if we ask people, how likely would you pay your taxes honestly, or do you think paying taxes honestly is important? So if you ask this question, then we see the same pattern. The richer a person gets, the more likely she will say that it's not so important to be honest. So it's not just something that we see on the behavioral side, but also the tax motivation among the wealthy is lower. So why is this the case? After studying, I don't know, several years, everything that we could find on the relationship between income and tax evasion, and also, of course, in-depth studying the available studies that really focused on the wealthy, we came up with the following conclusion. There are differences that might explain the difference in tax compliance on almost all levels, particularly on the political economic level, the social level, and also on the individual level. And I present you some of these differences in detail. I just give two examples on every level. If you read my paper, you can have much more examples. But let's start with the political and economic differences. On the political and economic macro context, there is a huge difference between wealthy individuals and average individuals, because the macro context gives much more opportunities to evade and avoid taxes, and at the same time also reduces moral concerns for tax evasion or avoidance. First of all, because of the opportunities that are offered by tax havens or secrecy jurisdictions. On the right-hand side, you can see the latest list of tax havens, and you see the first place goes to Cayman Islands. That's actually UK. The second place is the US, then Switzerland, Hong Kong is China, and so on. So what we see is that actually all industrialized countries are engaging in this business like it's an ordinary business, like being engaged in car. In the car industry, you're also engaged in the tax saving industry. So it's a very normal way of countries to get some money from abroad. There are also studies which show that if you increase the average tax burden, you get so and so much more foreign capital that is going into your country. So there is a big egoistic advantage of all countries to offer tax saving schemes to foreigners, basically. In the tax literature, we call this a race to the bottom. And this not only generates an atmosphere in which you have the impression that tax evasion and avoidance is normal, because actually, I mean, the United States, Switzerland, these are not shady countries somewhere or islands somewhere in the Pacific, but these are very respected countries. So why should it be wrong to exploit the law of the United States or of Switzerland? You surely have no moral concerns if you move your money abroad. We should add here that also there's a high hypocrisy going on in Europe. You see also Germany is on this list, many European countries. But if you see, if you take a look on the European Union's list of shady places of tax havens, then there is no European country on this list. They only talk about the bad islands in some Pacific places. So the tax haven is always the other country, whereas the own country is only offering financial services that should help their own economy. And that's a problem because of this hypocrisy. For sure, a wealthy person has no moral concerns. Moving money abroad is actually something normal. And if you do not participate in this international shifting of money, then you might even be seen as somebody who is stupid because he or she doesn't exploit the opportunities that are out there. So this is the first aspect that likely reduces moral concerns and in turn also tax compliant behavior of the wealthy. A second aspect is tax exceptions for philanthropic foundations. Just as an example, in the United States in 2016, the state lost $50 billion US dollars because of tax reliefs for charities. And there are large groups, think tanks and lobbies who claim that actually that's good, that are wealthy. They should put their money to charities and not put this money into taxes. because they founded companies and they are successful in managing problems. And so maybe these wealthy individuals are better in solving societal problems than the governments. There are very good books. Both of dissertations you see here deal with this relationship between taxes and charity. And they also analyze actually where the charity money is going to. And basically, most charities do not help the poor, but most charities help their own community, which means that most charities go to art or universities, which mostly are, of course, used by also wealthy or relatively wealthy individuals. So on the one hand side, these tax reliefs help the wealthy to move money away from the state into charity. So this would be something like tax avoidance. But above that, they also have a moral implication. There is one theory, it's called moral licensing, which claims that individuals who initially behaved in a moral way can later display behaviors that are immoral because they may believe that past good behavior frees them to do something bad in the future. This kind of behavior, I think most of us know it. It's, for example, during the whole week you were just eating salad and vegetables and really behaved bravely. And then, of course, it could happen that on the weekend you say, no, now I deserve the ice cream. I deserved this huge piece of meat because I was so brave during the last week. So that's very common. And it's also common in the tax arena. Field data found that companies with a good reputation more likely engage in aggressive tax avoidance than firms with a poorer reputation. So if you did something good, it frees you to do something bad later on. And often that is related to aggressive tax avoidance. The next level is the social level. So now we were talking about the economic and political context, the legal context, and now we talk about the social context. And first of all, I would like to consider the tax advisors, and next the social identity, so the social group of the wealthy. Most wealthy use a tax advisor, whereas an average person most likely would do the tax papers or the tax files individually. And already this basic difference by filing the taxes alone versus in a group makes a huge difference. Although we only recently started tax filing in a group, we can conclude from other research in a similar areas that the group context increases immoral behavior, unethical behavior. So in a group, you are following more likely the group norm. And if you are around a group of professionals who, are, of course, know the legal opportunities and also research shows have another ethical perspective on tax paying and tax honesty, then the norm is already such that it's okay to, of course, use aggressive tax avoidance schemes. And in this situation, it's very likely that the group moves to the unethical extreme. So already the fact that there is a group who decides very likely moves the tax decision to in the direction of dishonesty and avoidance. Also, of course, we should add here that these big companies, Deloitte, Ernst & Young, and so on and so forth, the big four, they invest a lot in their marketing activities because they have, of course, to make sure that everyone believes that the tax system is unfair and complicated and that you need their advice, basically. I mean, if the tax system would be good, then they wouldn't have any business, and their business is very, very big. So, of course, they try hard to make big companies and also individuals believe that they are needed and that their tax saving schemes are okay, of course. That's a big difference to individuals. Another difference is the social identity as a wealthy. Maybe some wealthy individuals just evade taxes because they follow the group norm. Imagine you are with your friends and they all tell you that they moved money abroad, that they used the Cayman Islands and so on and so forth, and that they have this good tax advisor who knows how to do it and so on. Then you might just feel stupid if you don't do it because you don't want to be the sucker that pays the taxes and all the others just leave. So you don't want to be the only fool who pays. Also, you might have the feeling that if all the others are moving money abroad, you also might fall behind the financial race. So the others can, I don't know, afford the next big thing, whereas you just paid your taxes to the state. So there's also the possibility that there is a group norm that, of course, is also influenced by this macro context and the opportunities in the legal system, that for an individual is very hard to go against this norm or to don't feel stupid to pay taxes, although all the others are talking about evasion and avoidance activities. Then there is another aspect, social distance to the average population. Many wealthy individuals live in separated neighborhoods, which do not allow much contact to poor or average citizens. And this also reduces empathy and the willingness to pay taxes. So particularly if you perceive taxes purely as a redistribution, or as something that redistributes wealth, then you might feel, okay, why should I move my money to the state and to redistribute wealth if this money goes to people who do not want to work and just didn't work as much as I did? Then of course you don't want to give your money away to people you do not understand, you do not know. So that's another aspect, that social groups emerge and these social groups establish own norms and classically also produce outgroups which are disadvantaged. Then the next difference is on the individual level. So also individual wealthy people are different to individual average people. First of all, on the cognitive level, there's a very nice study from Germany, which compares the personality traits between German millionaires and the average population of Germany. And this study finds that on these important personality traits, the wealthy are different. For example, they have higher scores on emotional stability, extroversion, openness, disagreeableness, and agentic narcissism. And also this is related to other social psychological research. Here actually we have a lot of research which is dealing with the differences on a psychological level, a personality level between the wealthy and average people. Often this research also uses priming, so you can even prime to be wealthy and then also you act differently. And in general, if you prime somebody to be wealthy, but also real wealthy individuals more likely have higher self-esteem, an increased sense of power, feeling of control, willingness to defend their view and to overcome restrictions compared to poorer individuals. If you are poor, then you're much more used to give in, to do what you are told. You don't have the freedom to choose, but you have to do what you are told. And there is another important psychological theory on reactance, which means that if you push someone and take away freedom of a person, then this person very likely will defend its freedom and even might do the opposite of what she or he is told. And we can assume that because the wealthy already feel much more freedom than an average person, the restriction of taxes even leads to more reactance in this community than on average taxpayers, because they are used to just do what they want. And finally, they should pay taxes, or even the tax authorities are pushing them, then they really might feel the need to fight back. And also they have the psychological and practical opportunities to fight back, because of course they have the financial means to, for example, go to court and fight against the tax authorities, because if they lose, they just lose money, but an average person even might lose the business. So there's another risk involved in fighting with the tax authorities, and also they are psychologically more ready to fight against the tax authorities. This is just an hypothesis, which I think we should test with real empirical data. A next aspect is fairness. There are different fairness perceptions among the wealthy and among the poor. First of all, if a wealthy person thinks that taxes are mostly used for redistribution, then this person likely thinks the taxes are more unfair because the poor cannot reciprocate. They cannot pay taxes and you feel that you just have to give money, but there's nothing coming in return. And this redistribution has no personal benefit. So if people think like that, then likely the tax motivation is also low. There's also another reason, and that is lack of knowledge. I did the study some years ago in Pakistan where we compared wealthy Pakistani who were registered at the tax authorities with wealthy Pakistani who were not registered at the tax authorities. So people who had villas and Porsches and so on, but they didn't even evade taxes, they were not even registered as taxpayers. And both groups filled in some surveys and we found out that people who were not registered, they knew much less about the tax system. They didn't knew anything of their rights. They had no idea how the system works. So I think this is a very powerful intervention to increase the tax compliance of the wealthy, to increase their knowledge on the tax system. Many do not even know their true tax rates. So informing them about the true tax rates, informing about what is actually done with the tax money, how much money goes into which public investments, surely can increase the perceived legitimacy of the tax system, the perceived fairness of the tax system, and maybe in turn also tax motivations and tax compliance behavior itself. Well, so what can we do with this observation that the wealthy are less motivated and also are different to average taxpayers? First of all, we should reconsider the classical tools we use to increase tax compliance. Classically, this is based on classical economic assumptions. Tax authorities rely on harsh, coercive-based audits and fines. So the assumption is nobody will ever pay taxes unless you force them to pay taxes. You need to constantly audit them and you need to really use large fines in order to motivate people to pay taxes honestly. And so, you have to use these coercive-based instruments. However, there's a big disadvantage. Many studies now show that the more you coerce people, the more likely they lose their voluntary compliance or the voluntary willingness to contribute to the system. They feel the restriction, they want to fight back. It reduces trust in the tax system and again the willingness to pay taxes. So it can be a vicious circle in which people do not feel any connection to the state, they don't trust the state, pushes harder, uses more coercion. People even more believe that the state is not on their side and are not willing to pay anything honestly. You have another tool as well, and that is based on the increasing legitimacy of the tax collection, which leads to voluntary compliance and increases trust. Legitimacy means that you send experts to the taxpayers, that you explain the tax system to them, that you show that you are benevolent and that you work for the honest taxpayers. Actually, if many people evade taxes, then those who are left, the honest ones, have to pay even more. You have to convince people that you only use coercive power to protect the system, to protect the community of the honest taxpayers. So the more legitimate the tax system is perceived, the more likely we trust the tax system, the more likely they have a positive intrinsic motivation to pay taxes, and the higher are the returns on the tax compliance side. Because of the specific situation of the wealthy, we can assume that the negative effects of harsh enforcement are even bigger among the group of the wealthy, because they have, as I said before, they have the financial means, they have the legal means and the psychological means to just leave the situation and run away from coercive instruments. And also we have some evidence from field experiments which show that high audits and fines increase the tax compliance of average taxpayers, but among the wealthy, they don't have any effect or even a negative effect. So what we can learn here is that we have to use coercive instruments, of course, particularly if we interact with criminals. But even more than for average taxpayers, we really should work hard to increase the legitimacy of the tax system and to use more interventions that increase this legitimacy. So what can we do on each of the levels we just discussed, on the macro level, meso level and micro level? First of all, on the macro, we need both. As I said before, we need the coercive instruments, but we should focus much more on the legitimate instruments. We need, first of all, this is what everyone says, we need a better legal system, which clearer than now, restricts moving money abroad and just run away from our community. And we need political willingness to do so. Of course, that is difficult with non-European countries. For example, if Germany says we now impose a Google tax or an Amazon tax, then Trump will say we now impose a tax on Mercedes and BMW and so on. So this is very difficult because it leads to some economic fights. But within Europe, it should be possible that we find maybe a common ground in which we have a more common legal environment that at least prevents German, Austrian companies to go to the UK to save taxes. What we need also are special revenue bodies, units, which only focus on the wealthy, who are experts on the tax situation, the legal environments of the wealthy. This is also something that the OECD is now proposing for years. But we just have a few countries who actually implemented such specialized revenue bodies. It's important that these revenue bodies focus on auditing activities, of course, but much more than that, they should be perceived as a service unit that helps to understand the latest legal environments, that calls this group regularly. For example, I think in the UK, one tax officer in this group is responsible for just 120 individuals and permanently calls them, invites them to bring money back and so on. So having a very close relationship to the taxpayer, not really highlighting that you of course can also use auditing schemes, but more highlighting the legitimacy of the tax system. Then we also need marketing campaigns, which first of all show that many people actually are honest taxpayers, that it's not normal to evade taxes. On the first slide of my presentation, you saw these famous wealthy people who evaded taxes, like for example, Ronaldo, Cristiano Ronaldo just evaded, I don't know, almost 100 million euros in taxes. And if people see that, they believe that all wealthy people are evaders, but that is not true. Many people honestly pay their taxes, and we should take dishonest people in the front. We should talk about them. We should appreciate much more what they do, and we should talk more about what we actually finance with the tax money, and that it actually gives many reasons to pay taxes, because of the hospitals, because of the roads, because of the schools and so on. Also making comparisons to countries with lower tax rates, for example, which do not in turn, of course, have these services. Like in the United States, you have a lower tax rate, but there is no public health insurance, for example. On the social level, we need a better regulation of the tax practitioners. Currently, the tax practitioners, we should much more influence the education of the tax practitioners. And in our paper, we speculated about something like what medical students have to do, the Oath of Hippocrates, I don't know how the Greek philosopher was called, but the point is that you also that you not see yourself just working for the taxpayers, but also for the community, that you are truly somebody between the tax authorities and the taxpayers, and not just on the side of the taxpayers. Because actually data shows that many taxpayers just want to pay taxes without having problems later on. So they don't want, or they don't engage a tax practitioner to evade taxes. They just want to write or to prepare the tax files correctly. They don't necessarily want to evade or avoid taxes. We also should use reputation mechanisms. in order to reward those who are honest. One interesting solution again comes from Pakistan, where only the wealthy who paid taxes were allowed to use the fast lane on the airports. Well, this is maybe not a solution for Austria, but definitely for other third world countries, that you really offer something that it's important to this group, only to those who were honest taxpayers. In the Austrian case or in the European case, you have to think of other things that might be perceived as a reward for the honest. You also should increase participation. Participation is one of the most important determinants of honest tax payments. The more people have the feeling that they can, or that they have a voice in how the taxes are collected or on what taxes are spent, the more likely they pay taxes honestly. On the individual level, we need well-trained tax auditors. So we need more tax auditors, but we also need well-trained tax auditors. They need to be experts on a legal basis, but also on a psychological basis. They have to know which kind of person am I interacting with. Is this somebody who is very has a very low tax compliance motivation, or is this a very motivated person? And depending on these motivations and on the preferences of such a person, you have to apply other communication skills and other communication targets to motivate a person to be more cooperative and more tax compliant. Responsive regulation is also a big theory in tax research, and it again highlights the importance of differentiating between the criminals on the one side, the honest on the other side, and many people who are something in between. And for each of these groups, you need to apply different instruments. And finally, the last aspect is appreciation and respect, which mostly relates to all the communication activities the tax authorities has with an individual taxpayer. So if you send out letters, it's easy to include some things that show appreciation, like thank you for your cooperation, or things like that. Or if you visit a taxpayer at home, you could say, okay, wow, it's really great what you, this company that you build up and these thousands of employees you have, that's really something great and good for the society, that you offer such a good job to so many people and so on. Everyone likes respect and appreciation, and especially this group likes it too. So you really could use these cheap instruments to increase trust, to increase a new level of cooperation with this group. Okay, so because we are in the middle of the Corona crisis, I spent some time to think of ways to use this research for the Corona crisis, because we probably, most of us agree that the tax contributions by the wealthy are more important than ever. We really need tax compliant individuals, also among the wealthy, of course, also among the poor. As we now, if you see the latest statistics, then you already can imagine that many people now move to the shadow economy, move away from regular work and start to engage in black labor. That's of course a big problem, but we have to get also the poor and average citizens back to the legal system. But we need also the tax compliance of the wealthy, particularly because they're role models. And if you can use some of them as positive examples, then other taxpayers follow as well, because they don't feel stupid if they are the only ones who are honest taxpayers. Importantly, I think we not just should talk about ways how to increase the tax rates on the wealthy. That's an important discussion. But we also should talk about ways how we can ensure that the taxes that should be paid now are paid, because we really lose a huge fraction of money to dishonest activities, to aggressive tax avoidance schemes. And if we do not solve these problems, then the honest people have to pay more and more and more. So we do not get the bad guys if we increase the tax rate. We only will put a bigger burden on the honest ones. And that is maybe not the best solution. So we really should try by employing more personnel, by employing more tax auditors, to really get the criminals and those who really exploit our system as much as they can, because then we also need to take less taxes from the others. We should employ these activities, however, with a very good communication strategy, because we do not want to frighten the honest ones. We just want to tell them we imply this aggressive, we imply these strict measures now to protect the honest. This is not, the honest shouldn't fear anything. On the opposite, we should reward the honest taxpayers. For example, in our case now, we sooner or later, we probably have to talk about how to increase the tax rates. And we should allow to participate in these procedures, which new tax regimes do we need, which sources can be taxed, which sources shouldn't be taxed. And those who are honest, not just among the wealthy, but also among average taxpayers, should be invited to have much more to say how this process should look like. Because this would increase transparency, it would increase perceived legitimacy, it would also reward the honest, because they can now, can have much more voice than the dishonest how the system should look like. So these are some ideas I had how we could use this research for the corona crisis. And now I want to conclude. I hope I convinced you that the wealthy are different than average taxpayers. And that we need much more research to understand the various motivations of this specific group. There is not one homogeneous group of the wealthy. There are many different groups. And we need to understand these differences in order to provide better tax policies. And these policies need to be tailored to these specific groups. And all of this can only be done if you have more empirical research, which ideally goes hand in hand with the tax authorities, for example, by implementing field experiments. Well, that was my talk. Thank you very much for your interest. And if you have any comments or questions, I'm happy to answer them. Thank you.
Okay, Katharina, please turn off your microphone for a minute. Thank you. We have otherwise we are in the same room, so we have a what you call in German a Rückkopplung. This is the first time we use this room and the first time we make this seminar in a virtual way, produce it in a virtual way. And one of the things that I've learned immediately is that I should have prepared better by asking Katharina whether she will give her talk in English or in German, because I made the introduction in German and she, of course, did her presentation in English. So I will briefly wrap up again for everyone who's listening in and is listening in is more prone to English. I just want to rehearse again that we are live streaming this event, but that we are also recording it and that it will then afterwards be presented on our webpage. That our data protection regulations are in the link under the Q&A section for you to follow up. That if you have any questions that you want to ask to this fascinating talk by Katharina, please post them also in the live event Q&A. I will read and then publish them. And then also, please, send us any other feedback that you have on this event, and I will gladly pass it on to Katharina. I have at least one question posted now in the Q&A by Kerstin Grosch. Thank you. I will come back to that in a minute. But first of all, I would like to ask Katharina a more general question. As a social scientist, you were talking about the wealthy and then contrary to the wealthy, about the poor and middle income people. And your paper is based on a literature review. How consistent is the notion of the wealthy in the literature? What group can we imagine is usually used there? Is there a consistency or is it rather inconsistent? Maybe this would be interesting to know in the beginning.
It's very inconsistent. Many colleagues use the notion of high net worth individuals, which means that you have 1 million euros, or also US dollars, in addition to the house you live in. So many researchers consider this as a wealthy person. In Germany, these are more than 1 million people, for example. So it's a rather big group. In the papers I review, I often just used on representative samples the relationship between income and other variables. And there you can imagine that the super wealthy, particularly this group, is not very well represented. However, it tells us that even if you observe normal wealth distributions, you still see that the higher the wealth is, the lower is the tax compliance motivation. I mean, it's not such a super big relationship if you just look at the representative samples, but still there is this negative relationship. But generally, of course, there's a very broad there are very broad concepts used. I personally also use this definition of 1 million in addition to their own household because it's easy and everyone understands it. In my empirical work, I now conduct interviews, in-depth interviews. I also use this definition, but of course it would be much better to have contact to people who own much more than that, but well, this is a population you can reach, let's put it that way.
Okay, thank you. I will pass on the question by Kerstin now. It is also in the Q&A section, but I will just briefly read it and then Katharina will reply to it. I was wondering if two factors make the wealthy more prone to tax evasion. First, greed, quotation mark, I have a lot, I want more, quotation end. Second, feeling of deservingness, quotation mark, I worked very hard for my money and I deserved all of it, quotation end. For both behavioral drivers, there is an experimental evidence, if I'm not wrong. Maybe Katharina can say something about these two potential drivers that are more relevant for the rich than for the non-rich. Katharina?
Well, this concept, this is a very good question, and we also thought a lot about greed. Maybe also in the social psychological research, there are many papers who make the conclusion that it's greed that drives wealthier people to more immoral behavior. But after reading a lot of these papers, I have the feeling it's not always so conclusive. And also poor people should be greedy somehow. And also if, well, I agree we should just test it in an empirical way, including other determinants, also using greed or the feeling of deserving the wealth. We should test it. I'm not sure whether it's one of the most important determinants. Surely among some people it's important, but not for others. A feeling of deservingness, it's very typical. And this, for example, I would think is also maybe relevant for the poor, because if you evade taxes as a poor person, you might, to yourself, you explain it also to yourself, an excuse that you use, yeah, I need the money, I deserve this extra income by being involved in black labor, so because I need this money. And so, of course, if you are wealthy, you have to convince yourself that you're in this position legally and so on. So, of course, you have to say, I worked very hard. And this is actually also what you see among many, but not among all of them. Up to now, I led like 20 interviews with wealthy individuals and I can't see any. They're all different up to now. So some are exactly what you describe, but many aren't.
We have two more questions from the audience and one comment. Oh, there are even more now. That's very good. And there is also a comment that I want to read afterwards. I just want to follow up here for a personal interest. You were mentioning on one of your slides that millionaires have a certain personality type. I mean, I'm totally not in this field, but I remember that I had a quite extensive that there seems to be quite extensive literature also on the personality type of managers, which is of course a little bit different than millionaires. But there, I had the impression that they differ from this personality that you described. Can you just turn off your microphone for a minute, because we're both live now, I think. So yeah, thank you. Just for now. And what I found interesting is the managers. One of the typical characteristics of many of them seems to be that they are more prone to be sociopaths. That's not probably the right term. I'm a layperson, so I may use this term. It's maybe not the right term in psychological, from a psychological term. But how would you make sense of this personality? Difference, or is this true? Is this something that you would say? Is it?
Well, I have to speculate a little bit about that, of course. But also for the millionaires, we find higher values for narcissism, and many of my colleagues measure narcissism in two ways: more an aggressive form of narcissism, and more a form of narcissism that is related to achieving things and to stand out, but it's not necessarily antisocial. So narcissism can have both parts, and also millionaires have higher values in narcissism than the average population, but not in this antisocial aspect necessarily. First, we had for a very long time in our paper, we also, because there's a huge literature which claims the wealthy have lower moral values. So it's a very easy claim, and you can sell it very good in the literature and also in the media. But it always seemed too simple to me to make this comment that these are immoral people. And we read more and more and so on, and then we finally came up with some papers who found that if you measure moral values and then put people into a powerful position, and then we concluded, okay, a powerful position is also probably related to wealth. So if you measure the values of people and then put them into a powerful decision position, then the values, they're much more free to show these true values. So what we can assume is that if you are wealthy, you are much more willing to show your true feelings, because you do not need to pretend to be a nice person, because you don't need anyone. If you don't have friends, doesn't really matter, because you can just buy somebody who helps you with moving the house next time. While if you are poor, you're much more depending on others, so you have much more risk of losing their friendship. So you should be nicer. So, and I think that makes sense. If you have moral values are probably equally distributed among the population, but if you are wealthy, it's easier for you to show your true attitudes, and that makes also sense, because many actually wealthy people have as their main job philanthropy. So especially among people who inherited a lot of money, you always find somebody in the family whose main business is to somehow distribute the wealth among things that are important. So I wouldn't necessarily say that. Also, there are many studies who show that in certain aspects, wealthy are more social and helpful and so on. So I wouldn't say that there is a principal difference in moral values. It's only that you are powerful, you're put into position, and then, yeah, it's easy to be and not so nice person.
Okay. We have three more questions. I think that would fit perfectly with the timing that we have. But first of all, I would just like to read a statement, which is not really a question, but maybe Katharina, you want to respond to it anyways. But the statement is from Thomas Davoine from the European Governance and Public Finance Group at the IHS. He said, I find the presentation very interesting, but I am missing the international competition literature, which shows that there can be benefits. I would therefore personally draw different policy conclusions.
I hope I got it. That's a very important comment. So I think our colleague was referring to the literature which shows that if you have lower tax rates, then you get more foreign investment. I'm not sure. I mean, I'm a psychologist, I'm not an economist. I'm not sure whether he was referring to this literature. But if he did, then yeah, that's true. If you lower the tax rate, the overall tax rates, you have a very high inflow of foreign money. But the problem is, if all of our countries are doing that, then we have this typical public good dilemma, and nobody pays in the end any tax. What should we do? How should we finance our state? If you go back in history, then we see the taxes emerged exactly at the same time when complex society emerged. So when hunter and gatherers became farming societies, the first taxes were introduced. Back then, these taxes were very harsh. Mostly this was like people were just standing on the street and just took money away from you when you passed the street. But this was a form of tax, and this money was used to build up the states we are living in right now. So all modern states depend on stable financial inflows, and mostly these are related to tax money. And so the question is, if all of our countries are reduce the tax rates to zero, how can we afford hospitals, roads, and so on? So we need a certain level of tax money. The question is, how can we bring it up in an efficient way, which is highlighting our democratic values? But I don't know if I got the term competition right, because as I said, I'm not an economist, I'm an economic psychologist. But thank you for the question.
Okay, there are quite a few now in the row, so we probably should just follow up with them. Michael is writing, thank you for this interesting talk. When talking about tax evasion by the wealthy, is this only about capital income, or is there substantial avoidance of labor income? And he follows up on this question. If it is on capital income, the perception is that saving was already done out of taxed income. And many people see capital taxation as some kind of double taxation. Have you run into this?
Yeah, thank you again for this question. Most of our research was or is based on income taxes and income tax compliance. There are different philosophies. Many colleagues think that we need to address tax compliance concerning each of the different taxes you pay. So you have to study the tax compliance of labor income, you have to study VAT tax compliance and so on, inheritance tax compliance. That's a total valid approach. I personally have the impression that if somebody wants to evade taxes, then they find their way and they will use income tax evasion if this is possible, or they will use VAT tax evasion if that's the more convenient way, or capital tax evasion. And if you evade taxes, you will always come up with some good arguments why this is totally okay. Or if you disregard, capital tax or inheritance tax, often many say that's double taxation. Well, if you say we all are equal, then I would also prefer to grow up in a family with some billionaires, because if I work hard and I pay, I don't know how much taxes, I don't even want to know it, but I pay a lot. Actually, somebody from a family who grew up in a very rich family and never worked doesn't have to pay any taxes on the money that is just getting on the bank account. Sorry, but that's not feeling very fair, and it's also not promoting it's also not promoting that the people actually want to achieve something, because if you already know from the beginning that the only thing that actually it's also a little bit true, but that the only thing that matters is the household you grew up in, why should you learn? I mean, actually, then everyone should start a drug business or human trafficking or something that really brings in money, because by legal means it doesn't make sense. You have to pay just taxes, whereas the others just were born with this money. So I'm, well, but that's of course, but if you think about it, then it's not double taxation, because the person who is taxed never paid taxes on it.
Okay, efficiency versus fairness is of course one of the, the driving tensions within the social sciences by and large, I think. There is a question by Jan Kluge. I somehow missed a few words about penalties. Maybe I really missed them, he said. People will refrain from evading taxes if the expected loss is high. Expected loss is equal to probability to get caught multiplied by penalty. Increasing the probability is expensive, but increasing the penalty is easy. So why do we think about hiring more auditors to smooth the rich and not about sending them to jail more frequently? Is it only the tax competition argument?
Thanks again for this important question, because from a classical perspective, it's income, it's the tax rate, it's the audit probability, and it's the fine. So particularly on audit rates and fines, we have tons of experimental studies. And what we know is that the audit seems to be more efficient or more working than the fine. We have to have very high fine rates to have them, to make them effective. I forgot the exact numbers, but it's like huge. You need to five times higher fines to see an effect, because people don't really, they care much more about being detected and being detected as an evader, and then having to interact with the tax authorities. Already that is for many already perceived as a fine, actually. Just paying back the money that you didn't pay before, this is not a fine, but many perceive it as a fine. So audits seem to work more than fines. And also, of course, I'm a psychologist, and I can use the situation of fining to also teach the people, to also tell them, okay, next time you should maybe you could use this in a different way. I can help you. I can have the chance to interact with the taxpayer, and that can help to improve cooperation. If you just use the fines, well, I'm not sure whether that is really working so well. Based on the empirical data, I'm not convinced that fines are working as tax audits would. And you have estimations, I just know it from Bavaria, employing one more additional tax auditor brings you I don't know how many million euros. So it really pays off, not just because you fine people, but just because you collect the money that should have been paid anyways. But thanks for the question.
Okay, I have two more questions coming up, and then I have a forward-looking question to Katharina to end this presentation. First up is a question posted by someone anonymously. Are there differences between the wealthy who inherited wealth and the ones who build it up themselves with regards to their tax compliance behavior?
Super question. I don't know yet. There could be both. On the one hand side, people who inherited the money, it was a windfall gain, should behave differently than people who worked for this money. You can see both. I'm not sure yet. I mean, on the one hand side, there is a very nice study from Michael Hartmann. He's a sociologist from Germany, and he did the study on the German elite. And of course, I also read this book, because the elite most likely is also also the wealthy. And there he also included a question on taxes. And what he found was that people who grew up in a working class family think taxation is are more ready to give up money for taxes than people who grew up in a wealthy family. From this, you would conclude, okay, if you grew up in a wealthy family, if you inherited a lot of money, you think, going back to the first comment from Kerstin, our family deserved that, my grandfather worked so hard, I deserved it. So of course, I don't give money away to the state. We should keep it in our family. If you worked for yourself and you grew up, for example, in a working class family and you experienced how important it is to have free education, for example, you're more willing to give up money. On the other hand, we always and often see families of people who inherited a lot of money and then spend a lot of it for the social cause. So up to now, I don't know, we both is possible. We need more empirical work on it. The cool thing is that just at the moment in Germany, they collect for the first time a huge data set on really wealthy individuals by simply contacting it in the owners of the big German companies. This will be the data and its analysis will be released this autumn, and I'm really looking forward to it because it will be the first time that we have a huge sample of very wealthy people and that we know about their, it's like a social, just the normal services you normally conduct with the population. And this time they really visited these people at home simply by using the data from the companies, which is publicly available, because of course, up to now, this data is very rare. It's very difficult to get. It's expensive to get. And I'm looking forward to this new data sets. And maybe then we know more about your question, because for sure they asked whether this money was inherited or built up by the people themselves.
Good. Thank you. Again, by the number of questions posed, we see how important and crucial this research and this research topic is. I'm coming to the last question by Thomas, who asks, what can science say about the following question? It's a very, very general introduction. Is it better for a country to have an inventor making big contributions to innovation and thus GDP growth, but evading some of its taxes, or have this inventor retire and thus make no contributions to innovation, generates no new income and thus does not avoid taxes anymore? Tricky one.
It's a tricky one, but of course it's a very good question. And I personally agree that it's better if, I think this is also the first time I read about that was this Tolstoy Peace and War. And there, these are the Russians and the aristocrats, they have huge farms. And of course the employees steal money. And one of them is saying, you shouldn't throw them out if they're good, because better to have somebody who is really pushing your farm forward and bringing in a lot of money. And if they steal a little bit of it, then it's okay. I think this is true somehow. The point is we have to make this, all of us should know that we can evade taxes easily, that we can avoid taxes easily. And it's often an individual decision how much we contribute to the common good. And so often it's also good for the whole of the community if somebody evades taxes and uses the money for the good. For example, many people in Austria build houses with the help of friends, which basically do not pay any taxes. But in the end, there is this house, which is a new value that was created. I'm not the one who says that all of this is evil. I just would make the claim that all of us individually have to make the decision what is right and when it's too much. And because in the end, it's about voluntary tax compliance. There is no law that will determine all the possibilities you have to evade taxes. It's so difficult because this is also a problem. Many people who like rules say, I will be honest, if exactly they tell me this is the number I have to pay, the problem is the legal situation is so complex that there will never be a situation in which the law exactly can tell you how much money you have to pay. In the end, it's an individual decision. It's always somehow a negotiation between the tax authorities and the tax payers. Thanks God, we don't live in a state in which they just come and take whatever they can get. It's a negotiation process in my view. And sometimes it's even good if somebody evades. And this also, of course, is something that lies in the eye of the tax auditor, that the tax auditor thinks, okay, how much do they contribute? I mean, if somebody contributes nothing to the state, so why should I let them survive? But if they contribute a lot and just take away a little bit, maybe also to have a good feeling that I'm not the stupid guy who doesn't evade anything, then maybe you shouldn't push too hard and destroy everything. But I think an experienced auditor maybe also know this critical line and how to intervene, and also a citizen which or who knows what we do with taxes maybe also know the line where we should stop exploiting everything that's possible, maybe. It's an important question.
And it's almost a moral question. Katharina, your presentation triggered a lot of interesting ideas also to me. The history of taxation, the effect of cohesion, social cohesion on these groups that you were describing, and so on and so on. I want to end with a more personal, forward-looking question to you. This is apparently an extremely hot topic. It's also kind of an emerging topic if we think that the book that, for example, Thomas Piketty wrote is only a few years ago, and I think this already only started this intriguing questions into this group of the wealthy and their relationship to society and to the state and to their behavior regarding taxation and so on and so on. I would like to ask you, or maybe the two questions, backward looking a little bit. For you personally, what was the most surprising finding for you when you were doing, while you were doing this research so far? What was really something where you thought this was a moment where, an eureka moment maybe even? And forward looking, what are going to be your next steps regarding this topic? What can we expect from you?
Yeah, thanks, Thomas. Writing this paper, I really took a lot of time reading on the history of taxation. That's true. And I have I don't know how many pages in this review, and many colleagues told me, well, you're a psychologist and this history part doesn't really fit and so on. But I really wanted to keep it because I learned a lot from the history of taxation, because actually many things were already tried out, and we can just look into the history on, for examples, how we could implement new forms of taxation. And one thing that I mean, this is something that is for somebody who does tax research, it's not so surprising, but something I really found very interesting, and maybe we can learn a lot of it about it, was that after the World War, the tax rate in the United States on income above $300,000 was 91%. And that was possible, and it was broadly accepted. There was no talking about, oh, that's too high and will destroy our economy. No, after the war, it was okay. And how did this happen that after the war, it was so publicly, it was okay, nobody complained about it? Because the state really needed money. After the war, all states were financially broken, the United States, but also, of course, in Europe. So the state urgently needed money. And there was a huge patriotic campaign calling all citizens to pay to pay taxes. And of course, they took the money from the rich, but they also took the money from the normal population. And to get the money from the normal population, they also said, okay, now we all of the workers now have to pay income tax. That was something that in this broad, that it was done to everyone, it was something new, because income tax was only invented in the middle of the 19th century, and after the war it was really applied to almost everyone, also because of the industry workers. And you could tax the masses because you told them, and the very rich, they pay 90% on income tax. And this was a single moment in the society, in our history. Nonetheless, what we can learn is, if history really pushes us, if we really need to collect the money, then we can do it. And the society also accepted. Also the rich people accepted, because they somehow see what we do with the money, what is needed. These things which were accomplished after the World War II were then lost, because tax systems became too complicated, more and more people started to cheat, and then there was neoliberalism kicking in and just turning all of this. So what I also, what also this, the acceptance of these high tax rates on the disregard of taxes has to do with the need of the societies for money and with public and intellectual trends. So people accept taxation if in the public sphere we can tell a history why this is important, if we can involve people in this, also by using patriotic feelings, I think. So this is something I really think we could also use maybe for the COVID-19 crisis, by now showing what we really do with the money, and that we need it, and that if we all together contribute our share, our fair share, then we can solve the crisis better than others and became stronger than we were before. Concerning the future, I already tried to get some money for third-party funding and so on, which was not so successfully. Maybe I'm more successful with my last proposal. What I do right now is very cheap. I conduct in-depth interviews together with my students. This is basically something I do because it's possible. I don't need any money. What I really would like to do is to have huge survey studies running with wealthy people, conducting online experiments with them, or maybe lab in the field experiments, something like this. But of course, that's you need a lot of money for collecting hundreds of people who have more than 1 million euros in income, plus besides the house they own. So you need just a lot of money to do this research. Comparably, it's not so much, but still, I don't have it at the moment. But if I would have it, I would definitely continue this. Another thing I like to do would is related to field experiments. I have to, it's good that I work now for the work here and have more this practical approach, because I already almost convinced the tax authorities of Colombia to conduct a field experiment on just on the wealthy. But the problem was that I had my theoretical questions in my head and just wanted to test out theories, no matter what people would think. Of course, I can do this normally in the lab with my students, because if the students didn't like the tax administration in the lab, I mean, nothing wrong can happen. But to the tax authorities in Colombia, I wanted to test between legitimate and non-legitimate letters. And of course, they didn't want to send out the non-legitimate letters, so I lost them as partners. I think I will be more clever now, just testing things that could work. Although at the same time running the risk that you don't have this this clarity, this theoretical clarity that you normally need to get good publications. But I think if you have this field data and this real people data, then it's worth to maybe step a little bit away from this theoretical pureness. Yeah, thanks for the question.
Yeah, thank you, Katharina. That's quite a task ahead, and I wish you all the best for your efforts. I think, as I said, it's an extremely important topic. I'm fascinated that you were collaborating internationally, globally, with Colombia, for example. Maybe we can have a
a session on that, separate session on that at one time again about how to collaborate with governments abroad and what we can learn from that. We're coming to our end of this first virtual EHS seminar. Thank you again to Katharina Gangl for an exciting presentation with lots of questions, lots of discussion. I just want to say thank you also to everyone who participated. Almost 20 people were here in the live stream, which is, I think, a very good result. We are also recording this, we have been recording this, we'll put this online on our website so everyone who's interested can watch again. Please also consult our website or our Twitter feed at IHS_Vienna to look updates for our next events. There is an IHS seminar coming at the beginning of July, but I think we will make another one in between. There are other events coming, and there is in particularly coming a session on living with Corona, Leben mit Corona, by the end of June, an interdisciplinary and intradisciplinary symposium on social science research and in the time of the Corona crisis. A lot of things that Katharina has mentioned now at the end will also be discussed there in depth. So I look forward to meeting you again. And for now, I say thank you for attending and have a good time, and please stay healthy. Bye.